To the Admiral at the Lake, we have a special presentation tonight. First of all, please, everyone, turn off your phones and electronic devices. We have a young man here tonight who is the grandson of resident Charlotte Zipporin.
Yay.
Charlotte, you stand up, because you knew enough, not everyone knew. And this young fellow, his name is Solon Snider. He is going to be a junior at Yale. Now, his resume is pretty impressive, and he's pretty young. Are you even old enough to drink yet? No. Sorry. No champagne afterwards. But he is working on his Bachelor of Arts in Music. He has had a fair amount of musical direction, including the all-male a cappella group at Yale. He has musical directed a new musical called Giovanni's Room and several other shows related to Yale. He's also a music and theater performer, wrote scholar programs. For those of you who participate in them, he has been involved with three of them this year. He is well-trained on the piano, the cello, and the voice, two of which you'll be hearing tonight. He is a tenor. He's performed in a chorus line in Man of La Mancha. He has another long list of other performing credits to him. He has also been an arranger and singer on a TV program called Odd Man Out that was just recently shown on Bravo in June. I suspect you can look for it on your own. Whatever that thing is that you look up. Things on your TV. It starts with an O and I can't remember. And he's also a composer and arranger of many things. So he's here to present a program all about Rodgers and Hart. I'm sure that this will be wonderful and familiar music to everyone. Rodgers and Hart, you will remember as Babes in Arms, a Connecticut Yankee, Pal Joey, the Boys from Syracuse. Those are four of 28 musicals filled with songs that you're going to love. So, Solon Snider.
Thank you so much. Hello, everybody. How are you all doing tonight? Well, I'm sure the first thing on your mind is, what is a 20-year-old doing telling us about Rodgers and Hart? And you're right to ask that question. If you went back a few months, I would not be qualified at all to talk about this amazing duo. And I'm sure you all have a wonderful background in listening to this music and are very familiar with it. But earlier this summer, I actually made a phone call. I was listening to the teaching company lecture series on musical theater history, and I gave the teacher a call asking if he'd teach me jazz piano, and he actually lived a little too far away for that to be realistic, but he offered me a job as his assistant for the summer, and so I've been trying to catch up to the rest of you and watch a bunch of movies from the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, trying to listen to all of the Rodgers and Hart I can, and next week I'm actually going to be co-teaching a course in musical theater history in West Virginia. I will be giving a presentation just like this and talking about some other things. So if you wanna travel with me there, you're welcome to join me. But I'm so glad that you've decided to take the time to come here this evening to celebrate the careers of Richard Rodgers and Lorenz Hart, two of America's most prized songwriters and cultural figures. The duo of Rodgers and Hart has left a lasting legacy on the world of American theater and American music. Without these two, it's possible that Broadway theater might never have evolved into the form we are familiar with today, a form with carefully constructed music inextricably linked to a well-crafted and often complex and thought-provoking story. Widely recognized and celebrated in their own time, sometimes their work is overshadowed by the Rodgers and Hammerstein shows we're more familiar with today. But Rodgers and Hart produce their own unique body of work and are worthy of our full attention and analysis. Today, we mostly hear their songs in isolated contexts. Many of their tunes have become jazz standards that are performed all around the world every day. They are notably popular with cabaret singers. For example, Ella Fitzgerald recorded their whole songbook. And while Jerome Kern, he hated when jazz musicians covered his songs, he thought they would ruin the songs, but Richard Rodgers did enjoy the attention. Late in his life, he did an interview where he said that this was a great way to keep the music alive, and as long as it doesn't stray too far from the original work, he felt that the Marcel's 1961 cover of Blue Moon, for example, went way too far. So tonight I'm going to try to stay true to his vision and not stray too far away from what he wanted people to hear. I'll probably be playing around 10 Rodgers and Hart tunes for you tonight. I'll play them in chronological order, following their career from the moment it took off in 1925 until it came, unfortunately, crashing down in 1943 with the breaking off of Rodgers and Hart and Hart's death the very same year. Before we begin, however, I want to give some basic biographical information about the duo. So we'll start with Lorenz Hart, who Richard Rodgers called Larry. Hart was born in Harlem in 1895. He was the son of immigrant Jewish parents, grew to be only slightly above 5 feet tall. He was a homosexual, and he was said to have a grotesque appearance. His childhood home was seen as bohemian. His father was a real estate broker with frequent run-ins with the law, and like Larry, was a complete night owl. The Hart home was open late at night for socializing, with booze, cigars, and food abound, and Larry was quite a popular guy, but his looks seemed to leave him lonely, so he turned to alcohol, unfortunately. He even wrote in his 1936 lyric for On Your Toes, "All night parties, drinking like a lord, fit into our social plan. Waking in the alcoholic ward is too good for the average man." Yeah, so it seems that Hart's anguish actually gave him great creativity. He is said to have had given brilliant encore stanzas during live performances on the spot. And when he was in high school, you could already start to see what he was going to become. He wrote in his school periodical, "I was small when I was born, and still am small, because my heavy brain does not permit me to grow in the vertical direction." I think this quote is a good summary of his life, a balance of deep inner pain and outward wit. Now, Richard Rodgers was born in Queens, not too far away, in 1902, also to a Jewish immigrant family. His father was a successful doctor. Today, we know Rodgers as one of the greatest American composers of popular song and theater of all time. He was the first person to win an EGOT, that's an Emmy, Grammy, Oscar, and Tony Award, and today he's the only person, along with Marvin Hamlisch, to have received all of these awards along with a Pulitzer Prize. He wrote his first songs in Maine as a child at Camp Wigwam, where the Hart family sent their son several years earlier. Interestingly, Stephen Sondheim's father, the son of the founder of Paramount Studios, Frank Lesser, and countless other leaders in the arts went to Camp Wigwam as well, so it must have been a pretty great place. Well, this camp was where Rodgers and Hart met. Rodgers was 16 and Hart was 23. Hart needed a composer, so he brought Rodgers to his home at 119th Street one Sunday afternoon, and the duo hit it off immediately. They worked together from that day until Hart's death in 1943. Rodgers once said of that afternoon, "I left Hart's house having acquired in one afternoon a career, a partner, a best friend, and a source of lasting irritation." Rodgers said that this irritation was that he could never find Hart. You had to lock him in a room and stay with him if you wanted him to write or work on anything. Their first number together was Any Old Place With You, which was written in 1919 and interpolated for a Broadway musical comedy called A Lonely Romeo. But the song didn't go anywhere, it didn't propel their career. Rodgers soon went to Columbia. He's very young at this point. It's pretty amazing he had something on Broadway at age 17. But he went to Columbia, which he found appealing because each year they did a varsity show, which is an original musical, and they still do that today, actually. When he was in high school, he saw the varsity show there with lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein, who he introduced himself to after the show. And in 1920, he wrote the varsity show called Fly With Me with Lorenz Hart in college. Not well known today, the show was actually set 50 years in the future, 1970, when communism had conquered the earth, yet love still triumphs. This was their idea of what the world would be like. The show itself certainly seems quite silly today, but Columbia University staged a revival in 1980 and made a recording if you'd like to take a listen to some of the very earliest works of Rodgers and Hart. The show didn't take off, of course, but producer Lou Fields actually used some of Rodgers' music for another show shared with the very successful composer of the time, Sidman Rodberg. This was the first professional show on Broadway that Rodgers did. He was, again, 17. At the time, he was studying at the Institute of Musical Art as well as Columbia, and this is now known as Juilliard. And this was his first, he was studying theory there. This was his first ever musical training. Prior to that time, everything was by ear, sitting down at the piano. He studied there for 3 years, but he couldn't get a full show onto Broadway. And in 1922, he was starting to become concerned with the uncertainty of show business. And so he was offered a job as a children's underwear salesperson. But that very same night, he was offered to write a musical review for the Theater Guild. He took this offer instead of the underwear sales job. This semi-professional show was only supposed to run for 2 performances in 1 day. The review was Garrett Gaiety's. The 2 performances, which did not see the light of day until 3 years later in 1925, went over so well that the show became a sensation, and it reopened less than a month later to run for 211 performances, which is about a full year. Thank God it did, otherwise Rodgers may have become an underwear salesman and would never have written another song. Rodgers and Hart took off, largely because of the success of the song Manhattan from this show. By the time Rodgers was 22, the Rodgers and Hart team had 3 successful shows running on Broadway at the same time. Every single year in the 1920s and 30s produced a new show, sometimes 2 or 3 in a year, for the team. This song, Manhattan, from Garrett Gaiety's in 1925, is the song that started it all. Enjoy. This one working. I'm told that this piano has quite a history. It's from 1902 and was part of the imperial court in Austria, and so hopefully you'll enjoy that. Here's Manhattan from 1925. We'll have Manhattan, the Bronx, and Staten Island. It's lovely going through the zoo. It's very fancy on Old Delancey Street, you know. The subway charms us so when balmy breezes blow to and fro. And tell me what street compares with Mott Street in July. Sweet push carts gently glide by. This great big city's a wondrous toy, just made for a girl and boy. We'll turn Manhattan into an Isle of Joy. That was the song that started it all for them. And after this great success, the careers of Rodgers and Hart took off. Between 1925 and 1931, the duo put on many successful shows on Broadway and in London, 15 full scores. These included Dearest Enemy in 1925, which contained the song Here in My Arms, The Girlfriend in 1926, including the song Blue Room, Connecticut Yankee in 1927, including the classic standards My Heart Stood Still, Thou Swell, and To Keep My Love Alive, and Present Arms in 1928, including the song You Took Advantage of Me. In the midst of the Depression, Rodgers and Hart were living the high life. Rodgers later said, "There are certain elemental things that are always gratifying. Eating, a warm bath, making love, and having a successful show." And they were doing that repeatedly at this time. In the early 1930s, the duo decided to move to Hollywood. Now, despite the jolly depiction of their time there in the 1948 film Words and Music, which some of you may be familiar with, Rodgers and Hart had many struggles out West, and Rodgers later regretted their time there. Much of the music they wrote out West was ultimately shelved, and though their time did produce some standards, such as Blue Moon and Isn't It Romantic, movie musicals were on the decline in this period, and the work was not easy. For example, for the 1933 film Hollywood Party, the duo wrote 21 songs, and ultimately only 3 were used. So now I'm going to play a couple songs from their time living out in Hollywood. And the first one is from the film Hallelujah, I'm a Bum, which came out in 1933. It starred Al Jolson. There's actually quite an interesting piece of trivia here. Frank Morgan appeared in this movie, and he said the line, "There's no place like home, there's no place like home." Now, this was in 1933. 6 years later, he was cast as the wizard in The Wizard of Oz. I have not found an explanation for that, but this may have been the inspiration for that line. And additionally, this song has a special meaning to me. During the year, one of the main things I do, I directed an a cappella group called the Duke's Men of Yale. Now, some of you may be familiar with the Yale Whiff and Goofs. They were founded in 1909. They were the country's first collegiate a cappella group. And the master of Saybrook College, which is a residential living community at Yale, which is actually where I live currently, he was a former Whiff and Goof, and he gathered 4 guys together, and he wanted to start a new group. And he took a song, which happened to be this song, which is called You Are Too Beautiful, which was the theme song in this movie, Hallelujah, I'm a Bum, and he created the a cappella group, the Duke's Men, which is my group today. So this has a special meaning for me. It's called You Are Too Beautiful. I hope you enjoy.
Like all fools, I believed what I wanted to believe. My foolish heart conceived what a foolish heart conceives. I thought I'd found a miracle. I thought that you'd adore me. But it was not a miracle. It was merely a mirage before me. You are too beautiful, my dear, to be true, and I am a fool for beauty. Fooled by a feeling that because I had found you, I could have bound you too. You are too beautiful for one man alone, for one lucky fool to be with. When there are other men with eyes of their own to see you with. Love does not stand sharing, not if one cares. Have you been not through a sense of duty? You are too beautiful, and I am a fool for beauty.
Well, this same year, Rodgers and Hart were working on a different film called Hollywood Party, which I mentioned earlier. And they started writing a song for Gene Harlow, which was called Prayer Make Me a Movie Star. The song went a little something like this. Oh Lord, if you're not busy up there, I ask for help with a prayer, so please don't give me the air. You've probably not heard that one. It didn't go very far. But MGM liked the melody, and they didn't want to get rid of the song, so they asked Hart to change the lyrics for a new film in 1934, a film called Manhattan Melodrama. This film did not do too well either, but they rewrote the lyrics, and this was the next version.
Act One. You gulp your coffee and run into the subway you crowd. Don't breathe, it isn't allowed.
So that was cut pretty quickly. It was called It's Just That Kind of Play. Now, that didn't last, but they still liked the melody. They wanted to keep it in the movie, so they asked Shirley Ross to sing another version in a bar scene later in the film, and this is actually in the film today. You still won't recognize it, but that version went like this.
Oh Lord, I could be good to a lover, but then I always discover the bad in every man.
So Hart, by this point, was pretty tired of working on this song, but MGM had not given up, and Jack Robbins was very attached to it. He was the head of MGM Publishing, and he managed to persuade Hart to make another round of lyrics. This time he said, write a conventional song, something with June or Moon. And this was probably said tongue-in-cheek, but it seemed to have stuck. And Hart, he was willing to do it again. And this time, I think you'll know this song. It became quite popular. Here's Blue Moon.
Blue Moon, you saw me standing alone, without a dream in my heart, without a love of my own. Blue Moon, you knew just what I was there for. You heard me saying a prayer for someone I really could care for. But then there suddenly appeared before me the only one my arms will ever hold. I heard somebody saying, please adore me. And when I looked, the moon had turned to gold. Blue Moon, now I'm no longer alone, without a dream in my heart, without a love of my own. Without a dream in my heart, without a love of my own. Blue Moon, you knew just what I was there for. You heard me saying a prayer for someone I really could care for. And then there suddenly appeared before me the only one my arms will ever hold. I heard somebody saying, please adore me. And when I looked, the moon had turned to gold. Blue Moon, now I'm no longer alone, without a dream in my heart, without a love of my own.
Thank you. Well, Rodgers really didn't like the life in Hollywood, but Hart, a lover of the nightlife, was much beloved there. He was always smoking cigars, cackling with laughter, bringing gifts to Rodgers, who he lived with, and he was quite loved. But that didn't mean he was happy there. He was very popular, but his love life was quite unfulfilling. He'd often get fixations on chorus boys or others who just would not find him physically appealing despite his charming personality. So despite their constant work, it seemed that both Richard Rodgers and Lorenz Hart were unfulfilled in Hollywood. So in 1935, the duo moved back to New York to return to writing musicals. Their first musical back in the Big Apple was called Jumbo. And I'll play a tune from that in just a minute. But first, I want to talk a little bit about a question which most people ask all the time, which is, well, with Rodgers and Hart, what came first, the music or the lyrics? In the case of Rodgers and Hart, the music always came first, and the lyrics were added, which makes sense if you understand that Hart wasn't ever willing to work. Rodgers had to usher him into the room and force him to write something, but with Rodgers and Hammerstein, the lyrics would come first. and the music would come afterwards. And so in my opinion, this lended itself to simpler musical forms in the Rodgers and Hart repertoire. All the songs I've played so far have had the same musical form, A, B, A. And actually, basically every song I'm going to play tonight has that form. Let me just explain that a little bit more. So in the song you just heard, The Moon, there's an A section, which is and then that's repeated. And then you get a B section. And later you come back to the A. That's as simple as it gets. A, A, B, A, no variation at all. But this next tune, which I think is quite a masterpiece, it's been covered by about hundreds of people, ranging from Doris Day to Louis Armstrong to Ella Fitzgerald to Janis Joplin. It's called Little Girl Blue. Now this song, you can analyze it as if it's AABA, but there's one unique element of it, which is in the middle of the song, there's actually a meter change. The song changes from 4-4 to 3-4. And some artists have used the 3-4 section as an introduction, but I like the way Louis Armstrong does it. He puts it right in the middle of the tune. So keep your ears peeled for, I don't want to ruin the song by yelling it out in the middle, but listen for a change in the meter. This is Little Girl Blue. It was originally sung by Gloria Grafton, and again, 1935, Jumbo the Musical.
Old girl, you're through.
sit there and count your little fingers. Unlucky little girl blue. Sit there and count the raindrops falling on you. It's time you knew all you can count on are the raindrops that fall on little girl blue.
Rodgers and Hart were enjoying the life back in New York and doing quite well, and they kept popping out musicals. And this, I'm going to play a couple tunes from an extremely successful show called Babes in Arms, which came out in 1937. There was a film adaptation in 1939. And I'll play two songs. I'm sure you'll recognize both. They're probably among the most famous songs of the Rodgers and Hart songbook. So here's The Lady is a Tramp, originally performed by Mitzi Green.
She gets too hungry for dinner at 8. She likes the theater but never comes late. She never bothers with people she hates. That's why the lady is a tramp. She don't like craft games with barons or earls. Won't go to Harlem in ermines or pearls. Won't dish the dirt with the rest of the girls. That's why the lady is a tramp. She likes the free, fresh wind in her hair. Life without care. She's broke, it's soak. It's California, it's cold and it's damp. That's why the lady is a tramp.
One of my favorite Rodgers and Hart songs, and I think probably their most remembered song. Here's My Funny Valentine.
Behold the way our fine feathered friend is virtue doth parade. Thou knowest not, my dim-witted friend, the picture thou hast made. Thy vacant brow and thy tousled hair conceal thy good intent. Thou noble, upright, truthful, sincere, and slightly dopey gent, you're my funny Valentine, sweet comic Valentine. You make me smile with my heart. Your looks are laughable, unphotographable, yet you're my favorite work of art. Is your figure less than Greek? Is your mouth a little weak? When you open it to speak, are you smart? Don't change a hair for me, not if you care for me. Stay, little Valentine, stay. Each day is Valentine's Day.
In New York, Rodgers increasingly was feeling that Hart was just very difficult to work with. According to Rodgers himself, Hart had many varied personalities. Although he was a good, kind, and sweet man, he was quite short, but Rodgers felt that people talk about him as if he were uglier than he actually was. Rodgers thought his face was actually quite handsome. Hart loved people, but in Rodgers' words, was not particularly interested in women. I think we know why. The fact that Rodgers is answering these questions, however, tells us that people have read a lot into how Hart's physical and mental states may have influenced his lyric writing. The next two songs I'm going to play, This Can't Be Love and Falling in Love with Love, are often cited as reflections of Hart's personal cynicism about love. However, Rodgers cautions against reading too much of Hart into his lyrics. He says that with both Hart and Hammerstein, the duos would always write out of situations and shows rather than out of personal philosophies. However, some argue that to a certain degree, it's impossible not to express the way you feel in your work. Right. I'll leave that up to all of you to decide, but in the meantime, enjoy these three tunes from the classic 1938 Rodgers and Hart musical, The Boys from Syracuse. This first one is This Can't Be Love. This was originally performed by Eddie Albert in the 1938 musical and Alan Jones in the 1940 film.
Ah.
in Verona, my late cousin Romeo was three times as stupid as my Dromeo. For he fell in love and then he died of it. Poor half-wit. This can't be love because I feel so well. No sobs, no sorrows, no sighs. This can't be love, I've got no dizzy spell. My head is not in the skies. My heart will not stand still, just hear it beat. This is too sweet to be love. This can't be love because I feel so well, and still I love to look in your eyes. This can't be love because I feel so well. No sobs, no sorrows, no sighs. This can't be love, I've got no dizzy spells. My head is not in the skies. My heart will not stand still, just hear it beat. This is too sweet to be love. This can't be love because I feel so well, but still I love to look in your eyes.
This next one, also from Boys from Syracuse, is Falling in Love with Love. This was originally performed by Muriel Angelis in the musical and Alan Jones in the film, which tells you that things can change a lot between a musical and a film. An interesting piece of trivia with this one is that in 1997, there was a movie version of Cinderella, which is a Rodgers and Hammerstein show, but they put in this song with Bernadette Peters singing. So enjoy. Actually, this song is the only tune without a B section the whole night. So that's it's just two A's repeated. So here's Falling in Love with Love.
Falling in love with love is falling for make-believe. Falling in love with love is playing the fool. Caring too much is such a juvenile fancy. Learning to trust is just for children in school. I fell in love with love one night when the moon was full. I was unwise with eyes unable to see. I fell in love with love, with love everlasting. But love fell out with me.
Show. This is Sing for Your Supper, and originally performed by Muriel Angelis, Mark C. Westguy, and Wayne Murray in the musical. So I hope you enjoy.
Sing for your supper, and you'll get breakfast. Songbirds always eat if their song is sweet to hear. Sing for your luncheon and you'll get dinner. Dine with wine of choice if romance is in your voice. I heard from a wise canary, trilling makes a fellow willing. So little swallow, swallow now. Now is the time to sing for your supper, and you'll get breakfast. Songbirds are not dumb, they don't buy a crumb of bread. It's said, so sing and you'll be fed.
Now, the time of the careers of Rodgers and Hart was running to an end. Besides By Jupiter, which Rodgers and Hart wrote the book and music for in 1942, which was their last new show, and the revised 1943 revival version of A Connecticut Yankee, Pal Joey was the duo's last and arguably most influential piece. Its innovative character writing brought complex and realistic characters to the Broadway stage. Brooks Atkinson wrote of the show in 1940, "Pal Joey offers everything but a good time. Whether Joey is a punk or a heel is something worth more careful thinking than time permits. Although Pal Joey is expertly done, can you draw sweet water from a foul well?" Well, the 1952 revival version, done at a time when audiences were more used to serious material, largely thanks to the work of Rodgers and Hammerstein, the revival was called Brilliant by Atkinson and had much more commercial success than the original run. There have since been several revivals, including a 2008 run on Broadway and a 1957 film starring Frank Sinatra. Beyond all this, however, the show's most lasting legacy may simply have been the hauntingly beautiful song sung by Vivian Siegel in the original musical version, and later by Lena Horne, Patti LuPone, and countless others, and by Rita Hayworth in the movie. From 1940's Pal Joey, with book by John O'Hara, here is Bewitched, Bothered, and Bewildered.
She's a fool and don't I know it, but a fool can have her charms. I'm in love and don't I show it, like a babe in arms. Love's the same old sad sensation, lately I've not slept a wink. Since this half-pint imitation put me on the brink, I'm wild again, beguiled again, a simpering, whimpering child again, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered, am I? I couldn't sleep and wouldn't sleep when love came and told me I shouldn't sleep, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered. Am I? Lost my heart, but what of it? She is cold, I agree. She can laugh, but I love it. Although the laugh's on me, I'll sing to her each spring to her, and long for the day when I'll cling to her, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I.
All right, everyone's gonna sing along for this next verse. I know you know the words. Here we go. I'm wild again, beguiled again, a simpering, whimpering child again, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I. I couldn't sleep and wouldn't sleep when love came and told me I shouldn't sleep, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered. I lost my heart, but what of it? She's cold, I agree. She can laugh, but I love it. Although the laugh's on me, and long for the day when I'll cling to her,
bewitched, bothered, and bewildered. Am I?
Well, Rodgers and Hart had an extremely successful New York run from 1935 to 1943. Things started to fall apart for the team after the Hollywood era. According to Rodgers, Hart was truly hard to work with. He loved the nightlife, and though he worked quickly, it was almost impossible to ever get him in a room willing to work. Rodgers wanted to keep working, but Hart was difficult to motivate. This made Rodgers increasingly frustrated as the years went by. Initially, Rodgers wanted Hart to work on Green Grow the Lilacs, which eventually became Oklahoma. But Hart wanted to go to Mexico for a vacation instead. So Rodgers warned Hart that he'd go to Oscar Hammerstein for the show, and Hart, according to Rodgers, was okay with it and didn't blame him for feeling that this was necessary. So Rodgers went ahead and did this, and we all know where that leads. However, the very same year, Hart's health began to decline, and he died a few days after the opening of the revival of Connecticut Yankee in November 1943. The year that Rodgers and Hammerstein saw their first great success was the year that Hart saw his demise. Hart's darkly comic view of the world seems to have shaped his own attitude about his work, which he didn't imbue with enormously great depth and substance in the same way that Hammerstein would sometimes do in some of his more philosophical lyrics. Rodgers, on the other hand, had a more earnest approach to life, which was a good match for Hammerstein. The two of them moved musical theater in an entirely new direction after Rodgers and Hart's relationship fell through. Rodgers and Hart broke off their partnership just before Hart died of pneumonia in 1943. Despite the enormous success and external recognition he received through his life, the end of Hart's life was characterized by his breakup with Rodgers, the death of his dearly beloved mother, pneumonia, and heavy drinking. But his words will never be forgotten. In addition to producing standards that we know and love today, Rodgers and Hart changed the American musical theater forever. Pal Joey is an extremely significant milestone in that it deals with complex, serious themes and has songs that emerge from character and situation rather than dialogue emerging from song. In addition, A Connecticut Yankee, based on Mark Twain's novel, and The Boys from Syracuse, based on Shakespeare's The Comedy of Errors, helped raise the standard of the Broadway musical, ushering in a new era of substantive librettos rather than reviews where any dialogue often served merely for laughs or for ways to cue the music. And Rodgers and Hart were the first to bring ballet as a central piece into a musical with 1936 Slaughter on 10th Avenue jazz ballet for the musical On Your Toes, choreographed by George Balanchine. The duo paved the way for Rodgers' future work with collaborator Oscar Hammerstein and the making of the musical as we know it today. I'd like to end the evening with a tribute to the duo. I'm cheating a little. This is a classic tune called All the Things You Are. It's not a Rodgers and Hart tune, but though it wasn't intended this way, I see it as a salute from Jerome, Kern, and Oscar Hammerstein, thanking Rodgers and Hart for all the things they've done for us, for America, and for the world. I want to thank the Admiral so much for allowing me to perform here, and to Lois and Sue Peverly for arranging all the logistics of this event. I'd like to thank Bill Porter, who's sitting in the third row right there, for letting me practice all this week on his lovely piano, and he was great company, and we got to nerd out on some music history, which was great. And finally, I'd like to thank my grandmother, Charlotte, for allowing this to happen in the first place and for letting me share this music with all of you. So thanks to everyone for coming out and joining me tonight, and here's All the Things You Are. Things I know are what you are.
someday my happy arms will hold you, and someday I'll know that moment divine when all the things you are mine.
Bravo. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would ask those of you who came with vehicles into the room to please wait for a few moments. Your valet will bring your walker to you. The rest of you, please. Have a lovely evening.